Right, so Israel's most obnoxious mouthpiece, arguably. That's quite a high bar, isn't it? The British-born Eylon Levy has apparently been sacked by Benjamin Netanyahu after managing to upset the UK government. Our government! By getting into an argument on Twitter with David Cameron, of all people. The official line is he's been suspended but is unlikely to return. So is that just a very long-winded way of saying sacked then? Well, I certainly read it that way. But Levy has become well known for as a literal apologist for anything Israel is doing, but has also been one of the most familiar faces on our TVs because he's basically capable of stringing together more than two words in English to go before English-speaking cameras to propagate the propaganda and the snake oil that the Netanyahu regime want promoting. But given his only use to the Israeli government is his English-speaking capabilities, when he's managed to embarrass Israel by annoying one of the key English-speaking governments that happen to still be arming them at that, well, what use is he to them anymore? Right, so Eylon Levy, Benjamin Netanyahu's favourite English-speaking rent-a-gob, his go-to bullshitter-in-chief, a guy who will do anything and say anything and literally defend anything in servitude to the Israeli regime, has fallen out of favour with Bibi and has been suspended, in all likelihood permanently, as the narrative that several media outlets are carrying, because of a stupid spat on Twitter, of all things. It doesn't matter how much drivel he's peddled on the media that he hasn't always been bright enough to be able to refute, but he's finally gone too far in having a pop at David Cameron, of all people. Now, the UK government, who have been nothing but slavishly loyal to the Israeli regime in backing them and supplying them with arms and military aid, what did he hope to achieve by having a go at them? Did his ego finally get the better of him? And indeed, do we really care as long as he's gone? Because nobody's going to miss him, are they? Frankly, every day should be Suspend Eylon Levy Day. Fired as he seems to be, what else does permanent suspension imply? He's only got himself to blame. His arrogance has been off the charts. For 5 months, he's had practically free rein across all of our mainstream media with next to no accountability. And he finally got caught up in his own hype, his own lies. Looks like that's ended up bringing him down. So what happened then, Damo? Well, it all began with a David Cameron tweet. Cameron put out a message saying, "People in Gaza are in desperate humanitarian need. Alongside the US, the UK and partners have announced we will open a maritime corridor to deliver aid directly to Gaza. We continue to urge Israel to allow more trucks into Gaza as the fastest way to get aid to those who need it." Now, I covered this Gaza port business in another video. I don't believe for one moment it's all about aid. Not when queues of aid trucks on the border are sat there stuck, when they're putting soldiers into this port that they could be deploying to these border crossings to force that aid through and deal with the people who are obstructing it. It's all unable to get in because of Israeli protesters wanting the people in Gaza to starve to death and are saying the supplies will go to Hamas instead. Why could they not put soldiers there to deal with that? It's all drivel as well. We've seen the effects of starvation in Gaza across social media. Well, Levy sent a rather pompous response to Cameron saying, "There is no capacity problem for the aid trucks at the Israeli crossings. Send trucks, they'll enter." Now, even the UN are saying aid trucks are not getting in as they should be and as they need to be. And that is on Israel, since they could do something about their own people hell-bent on obstructing it too. It's their own people, after all. But with this message coming from an official Israeli spokesperson, the UK government asked their counterparts in Israel for clarification. As you probably know, the foreign minister discussed the humanitarian issue at length with the Prime Minister, the Foreign Minister and Minister Dermer. These tweets surprised us given the constructive dialogue between the countries coming from a good company and ally. We would be happy to understand if these tweets actually attack the position of Foreign Minister Cameron and if they reflect the official position of the Israeli government. Well, they didn't. But this wasn't the only incident between Levy and the British government. Tory MP and Chair of the Foreign Affairs Select Committee, and as much as I loathe the idea of giving any Tory any props, Alicia Kern certainly had the measure of the even worse Eylon Levy. She had also taken to Twitter and quote tweeted another Cameron tweet, and only hers said, "Israel has legal responsibilities, including the provision of aid, water and medicine to civilians. Its legal obligations are not being met. More aid needs to get in now. I've just returned from the aid staging location in Egypt. Thousands of trucks are sat waiting to deliver aid. US proposals for a port will be slow, too slow, and shows impatience and exhaustion and inability to ensure current aid routes flow sufficiently. To reduce the humanitarian crisis in Gaza, open more overland aid routes, use one consistent list of approved items and packaging, switch water back on in full, allow more medical evacuations, open crossings for more hours, and more trucks in Gaza to distribute aid. Let's hope a ceasefire is reached this week and hostages come home, but more needs to be done now to save lives. Eylon Levy didn't like this and popped up in a reply saying, "Hello Alicia, Israeli government spokesman here. Are you aware the Kerem Shalom crossing is currently closed on Saturdays at the request of the UN because there is so much undistributed aid piling up on the other side? The problem isn't getting aid in, it's getting it around." Well, that's what UNRWA is there for, isn't it? They are a UN agency. They're not singing from your particular hymn sheet, Eylon. So Kearns replied, "Thanks for your comments. Please provide evidence of the request by the UN to close on Saturdays. This is not what the UN told us yesterday, nor is it recognised by aid agencies and governments I've spoken to. The problem is getting aid in. Why do we see so many rejected items, including from the UK government for shelter and medical aid? I saw neonatal resuscitation kits, sleeping bags, productive health kits, educational boxes and more all rejected. I recognise dual-use items such as solar lamps must be rejected and support Israel entirely in that. Governments have asked why crossings aren't open 24/7 and why more crossings aren't open. The UK government has made these requests to the Israeli government because it is with the Israeli government that these decisions sit. UN and UN donor countries stand ready to surge aid. There is a capacity issue inside to distribute, I agree, and agencies would welcome more trucks inside Gaza. But this is partly due to a lack of deconfliction, making it difficult for humanitarian staff to deploy, and rejections of notifications to deliver aid. This is the assessment of governments and UN agencies." A lot of valid points. She had just been out there, and there are actually 7 crossing points into Gaza from Israel. Not all of them are open. Levy has deleted his tweet in reply to that, but it got screenshot and it read, "I hope you are also aware that there are no limits on the entry of food, water, medicine or shelter equipment into Gaza, and in fact the crossings have excess capacity. Test us! Send another 100 trucks a day to Kerem Shalom and we'll get them in. There are 30,000 tons of supplies stuck waiting to get in because they can't. Another 100 trucks a day? The man's incredulous." Kearns continued though. "Eylon Levy, grateful for your keenness to discuss. Can I follow up on the evidence you have, RE, your claim, UN requested to close the gates on Saturdays, as it's in direct contrast to what UN and British government has told me? Also, clarity from you that when you said no limits on food, water, medicine and shelter equipment, that there are limits on the hours the crossings are open imposed by your government. Also, that whilst you say no limits, that there are rejections of tons of these items, including baby resuscitation kits and water storage items provided by the UK government, which you can trust are not dual use or false representations of items. I will ask the UK government to test you as you ask. I take your post as confirmation that 100 extra trucks a day carrying food, water, medicine and shelter equipment from the British government will not be rejected or refused entry." Well, Levy came back at that with another smug answer. "Thank you for engaging. This is the Israeli unit responsible for facilitating the transfer of humanitarian aid into Gaza. They will be happy to help you with any questions you have." And he quote tweeted a tweet from COGAT at this point, the Coordination of Government Activities in the Territories, which again Kearns followed up because they essentially echoed Levy's comments here. But Kearns wasn't finished with Levy. By this point she'd become aware that that aforementioned tweet from earlier had been deleted, and she called him out on this, and then some. "Why did you delete your tweet to me on this? There are limits. Is it not true that crossings have excess capacity? I had hoped this was an offer from your government to increase trucks by 100 a day, which international community would gratefully accept." Well, she's read it as Eylon Levy speaking on behalf of government, and he was more than happy to put himself forward in that role, but he wasn't authorised to do so. And he did go rather quiet at this point. He'd now not only upset the British Foreign Office, but had publicly caused a diplomatic incident, having a spat with another Tory MP publicly on social media, putting himself forward in a position he had no authority to hold. It's not even just the British government, nor indeed pretty much everyone who's come across Eylon Levy's rancid defences of Israel who have come to dislike him. Even Benjamin Netanyahu's wife can't stand him, and has apparently been pushing behind the scenes for him to go, which is just one more reason to surmise he's now gone for good. He'll just be replaced by someone else, though. But for now, we can enjoy the fact we're not likely to see any more of this smug git on our TVs. Though sadly, extremist views from others will still be platformed, as this video recommendation here will tell you all about. The BBC, no stranger to platforming them. And I'll hopefully catch you on the next video. Cheers, folks.